Good morning, RCC. Hey, yeah. Hi, I heard my name. That's great. My wife reminded me to say my name for service. So, yeah, I'm Eric. Pleased to meet you. Welcome to RCC. Anybody do anything fun yesterday? Super fun? There's some Nate, what'd you do? 102 on Tetris. Nice. My kind of guy. Gaming. Game it up. We'll have to talk more about gaming, Nate. Yeah, welcome to RCC. Hey, look what I'm wearing.
That looks like one of the amazing RCC sweatshirts. And Andrea is wearing one as well. You can buy an RCC sweatshirt online or from Annie on Facebook. But you can also get a t-shirt, and you can also get a long sleeve t-shirt. And Eric kind of knows this, but I'm buying one of each.
She has all of them. Hey, missions commitment forms. This is how we tell our missionaries that this is what we've planned and committed to support you for the rest of the year, so they can make plans for what they're going to do, where they're going to go, what they're going to do.
So there's
Healing Hearts.
Anna Marie.
Anna Marie Mazzoni in Germany.
So powerful.
So powerful, right here and in Zambia.
Arise, which is Yesir and Mo.
Arise Ministries. Gil and Gloria Gravel with the seed company. Those are ours. They're not up there. They're not up there. But if you fill that out, and you can drop that off with anybody here at the church, appreciate it. Our missionaries appreciate it. That's what we choose to give above our tithe to say, hey, we love you and what you're doing, which is what we're supposed to be doing, which is reaching our community and our world, right? Yes. Let's. She wants it back.
Hey, guess what? You can tithe on your phone. You can tithe in the box in the back. You can tithe online. You can do your offerings and tithe in the mailbox. You can tithe just about anywhere you want. Here you go, Eric.
You can bring it in here and hand it to the people at work during the week because they love visitors. They don't get out much. Let's pray for our tithe. Jesus, thank you so much that you love us all day, every day. It never changes. Jesus, we so appreciate that. You never go away. You are beside us, behind us. You lead the way. Lord, thank you for your ever-present love. I pray you would bless the service, and we look forward to hearing what you have to say, Jesus. Amen. All right, let's worship.
Same old road for miles and miles. You've been hearing the same old voice and the same old lies. If you're trying to fill the same old walls inside, there's a better life. There's a better life. You got pain. He's a pain taker. Search for the light of day in the dead of night. We both find ourselves worn out from the same old fight. We both run to things we know that just ain't right. And there's a better life. There's a better life. If you got pain, he's a pain taker. If you feel lost, he's a testify, testify. If you believe it, if you receive it, if you can feel it, somebody testify. If you got pain, he's a pain maker. If you feel lost, he's a way maker. If you need freedom or saving, he's a prison shaking savior.
Nothing else will do.
child in awe of you.
By the number of people, but we are just encouraged by your presence. We
worship you, Lord. We bless you. We give you all the honor. Thank you, Father, for those that are watching at home. Continue to worship him. You might not be here, but we are in the spirit together, just worshiping and exalting the name of Jesus, the name that is above every other name. We thank you, Father, for bringing us this morning to thank you. And Lord, as we come together, even to give our tithes, our offerings, our pledges, Father, we pray those that have given, that you may bless them, O Father. Give them abundantly, O Lord, as your word says that good measure pressed down, shaken together, will men give back unto our bosoms, O Lord. Thank you, Father, for the gifts that have been given. We pray that you use the gifts, Lord, to build your kingdom, O Master. And Lord, for those that do not have, that Lord, you will provide for them a way so that they can bring in something into your house and that you will bless them. I thank you, Father. I glorify your mighty name. Be exalted. As we continue with the service, Lord, help our hearts to humble ourselves, to remove any calluses in our hearts, that as your word is spoken to us from your throne, Jehovah, it will find root and it will be anchored within our souls and our spirits, that it will bear fruit, O Master. Thank you, Father. We ask that you bless this service as we begin and even as we end, for the glory and honor of your name. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. We worship you, Lord. We bless you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
Amen. Thank you, Ruth. Church, that is your new council member, Ruth Muasi. I asked her if we need to address her as Councilwoman Ruth from now on, and she said, she assured me, no, we don't have to do that. Good job, you guys. Thank you. They're just going to keep playing the whole time. Is that okay?
Yeah.
All right. Thank you all. Hey, just during worship, I just felt like a word came, and maybe some of you are feeling a little flat in your life and the things that you're doing, and you're feeling a little like disconnected. And I just want to encourage you and ask you this question: who are you living for? Who are you living for? Because if you're living for yourself, yeah, it's going to be flat, and it's going to be, honestly, it's going to be disappointing. Because we can never satisfy ourselves, ever. And the things we run after and the things we chase and try to grab onto, they'll just leave us feeling more empty than when we even first started. And so I just want to encourage you that we have to live our lives for him. And when we do that, we just know that his promises come true, that he'll just make everything else work for us and settle around us if we keep our eyes on him and live for him. We're going to look at a man today whose life was dedicated to live for the King of Kings and to point people to the light. But before we get into the book of John this morning, I missed this first service. I was so excited to open up the book of John. I forgot to ask. You know, we had a prayer walk yesterday, a church-wide prayer walk, and instead of meeting here in our foyer and then going out and praying and then coming back, I just asked you guys, would you pray in your communities? Would you go out of your front doors into your own neighborhood and walk your cul-de-sacs or your long streets, as some of you guys have, and just walk? And so I want to just say, I want to have a time real quick. As anybody did that, did you guys, like, the Lord, like, give you a word for, like, a neighbor or a friend, or you stopped and prayed for somebody? And if you're watching from home, I brought my phone up this service. Text me and let me know. And I would love to be able to just have a few moments this morning, like right now, for those of you that were able to get out there and pray. Do that. Anybody? No pressure. Text me if you want, if you're at home. You'll hear it go off if it's sitting right there. Well, we walked out of our front door yesterday to pray for our neighborhood, and immediately as I walked out the front door, I saw this about 4-foot blue cord thing sticking out of my gas tank. And I was like, oh, someone siphoned the gas out of my car. And then I went to pull it out, and it wouldn't come out. And so I had to, you know, get down there, and it, finally I was able to pull the thing out. It was about 6 feet long or so. Someone in the middle of the night or whenever tried to siphon gas out of my gas tank. So that's how my prayer walk started. And I was like, okay. Talking about being distracted. And so we started our prayer walk, and I just felt the Lord, like, for me, as we're walking down the street, I guess just happened in the last week or so, about 4 houses down, somebody walked by and broke the windows out of 2 cars that were right there. And I just felt the Lord was saying, you need to pray for a spirit of generosity over your neighborhood. Because the spirit of, like, theft and vandalism, and I just don't care about my neighbor. And so I'm just going to walk by and throw garbage in their bushes and on the ground. And I just felt the Lord say, I want you to pray generosity over your neighborhood. So that was the word the Lord gave me as I was walking through. And sometimes that's really hard to pray right after you just realize that someone tried to steal gas out of your gas tank. And so that's what I was doing. And then we ran into our neighbor, and we got to talk to our neighbor for a little while, and we prayed for his knee. We've been bothering. And I just, you know, true confessions of a pastor. You know, you're out walking in your neighborhood, and you see people that you know and or you kind of know. My wife is awesome at knowing who our neighbors are. I know very few of our neighbors, and we've been there for a long time. So that's another thing the Lord convicted me about. Like, you need to know the names of your neighbors and pray for your neighbors by name. And I just need to get out there and say hi. So I was, you know, whenever you're standing next to somebody and the Lord is like, hey, I want you to pray for his knee. And you're like, oh, he doesn't want me to pray for his knee, really? And so I said, okay, hey, so we're talking. I said, hey, David, can we pray for your knee? Well, like, sure. So we prayed for him right there on the sidewalk and asked God to bring healing in his life. And, yeah, it was awesome. Just an awesome time. So nobody's texting me. Oh, excuse me, it's my mom. It really is. My mom said she went out onto her front porch and prayed for the neighbors. So good job, Mom. It's awesome. So I want to encourage you. We're going to start doing this on a regular basis. We don't have to come here and then go out. We're just going to walk in our neighborhoods. Does it have to be on a Saturday at 10:30? No. We are just setting a time. Could it be every day? Some of you guys like walk every single day. Then what do you do during your walk? Well, maybe once a week or twice a week you turn off the podcast and you pray. The Godcast. Yeah, turn on the Godcast. Yeah, that's good. Hey, turn to John chapter 1 this morning. We're going to be talking about John the Baptist. John the Baptist. Not to be confused with the Apostle John. See, the Apostle John, the one that got the disciple that Jesus loved, how he self-described himself, and we learned that in the first week. That's really all of our names, that we're all the disciples that Jesus loved. Yes, Douglas is handing out Bibles. If you need a Bible, we'd love for you to grab a Bible this morning. Okay. Thank you, Douglas. So the author of John, the book of John, also wrote 1st, 2nd, 3rd John, and he wrote the book of Revelation. But in his book of John, John writes about John. Not himself, but about John the Baptist, 2 different guys. So I want to really make that clear this morning, that John the Apostle is writing about John the Baptist. Now we're going to just read verses 6 through 8. John chapter 1, page 911 in your church Bible. There was a man sent from God whose name was John, and he came as a witness to testify concerning that light, so that through him all might believe. He himself was not the light. He came only as a witness to the light. Why is John talking about the light and John talking about, yeah. Because early on, as the introduction, John says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, and the Word was with God. He was with God in the beginning. And talks about Jesus being the light of the world. And a lot of people thought John the Baptist was the light. That he was the prophet, that he was Elijah. And we're going to read that this morning. But he was only there to point people to the light. And in the midst of like a light room, it's not very obvious. But we have to understand that in the context of the Gospels, that heaven had been silent for 400 years. So theologically, that's a tough one. So why was God, why, if you loved your kids, why were you quiet? I mean, it's hard to be quiet for 40 seconds. We're talking 400 years. God, why were you quiet? And you can imagine how squirrely and twisted life had gotten and how dark. And we talked a little bit about it a few weeks ago. The celebrations of Valentine's Day back in Rome's day was wicked and perverse and evil. That's how twisted it was. And so it was dark. Janet, it was dark. Good job. Thank you. She was so cued in on me. There you go. It's really obvious that the light is here in the darkness. And it's not even that dark in here. But it's really obvious that the light is here. It was dark, and yet John was sent by God to point people to the light. They weren't even looking for the light in the darkness, and it was obvious it was Jesus. So John was sent to prepare the way for Jesus to come. So who are you living for? Who are we living for? And why are we doing what we're doing? We're all to be like John the Baptist and to prepare the way for Jesus and to point people to the light. What we know about John is he was sent from God. We know from John that he was an eyewitness to the truth. And what we know about John is that he pointed people to Jesus, that he was made and created to prepare the way for the Lord. What else do we know about John the Baptist? Well, we know that in Luke chapter 1, that he is actually related to Jesus. We don't know exactly, we assume it's a cousin because Mary has an encounter with the angel. We all know about that encounter. We celebrate it every year. And in that announcement to Mary from the angel, she said, as a sign, the angel said, even your relative Elizabeth, who was told couldn't have kids and is very old, she is with child. She's actually 6 months pregnant. And so, oh, Elizabeth, your relative. So we know that John is related to Jesus. John the Baptist is related to Jesus, cousins. So turn over to Luke chapter 1. We're going to look at that real quick. Luke chapter 1. So Mary hears what the angel has to say, and the first thing she does is she runs to her cousin's house or her aunt's house. Verse 39. At that time, after hearing the message, Mary got ready and hurried to the town in the hill country of Judah. Verse 39, yes. Verse 40. Where she entered Zechariah's home and greeted Elizabeth. Zechariah was just probably standing at the door and going, You guys will get that in a minute because Zechariah couldn't talk. So why couldn't Zechariah talk? Well, look back in the early part of Luke chapter 1, verse 11. So Zechariah is a priest. He is serving God. It's his turn to go into the temple and light the incense and be in the presence of God. And in verse 11, Luke chapter 1, then an angel of the Lord appeared to him, standing at the right side of the altar of incense. Then Zechariah saw him and was startled and was gripped with fear. But the angel said to him, do not be afraid, Zechariah. Your prayer has been heard. Your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son, and you will call him John. And he will be a delight to you, and many will rejoice because of his birth. For he will be great in the sight of the Lord, and he is never to take wine or fermented drink, and he will be filled. I love this line, church. And he will be filled with the Holy Spirit even before he is born. What do we think about babies? John was filled with the Holy Spirit even before he was born. He will bring, verse 16, he will bring many back, many people back. Let me read that again. He will bring back many of the people of Israel to the Lord their God. And he will go before the Lord in the spirit and power of Elijah and turn the hearts of the parents to their children, of the disobedient to the wisdom of the righteous, to make ready a people prepared for the Lord. John was preparing the way for Jesus to come. He was sharing that we need to get ready, that the Messiah is here. He is coming. John preached repentance, that we need to turn from our wicked ways. We just talked about it a few seconds ago, that yeah, it was a wicked time. It was a dark and twisted, squirrely time. And John says, we need to leave all that stuff. We've been living for ourselves. We need to live for God. We need to turn back to him. And then verse 18, Zechariah asked the angel, how can I be sure of this? I am an old man and my wife is well along in years. Just a side note to the men in the room. There's a few men in the room and a few of you watching from home. This shows a lot of wisdom from Zechariah right here. Because I want you to hear the wording of this. Zechariah is talking to the angel. He confesses to the angel, hey, I'm an old man. But he doesn't turn and say, and my wife is old too. Because that's unacceptable, right? Women, right? And so how he phrases it, my wife is well along in years. Whatever that means. But it sounds a lot better than this lady's really old too. And so he has this conversation, an honest conversation with the angel. Like, how is this going to happen? We're old. We're really old. And the angel says in verse 19, I am Gabriel. I stand in the presence of God, and I have been sent to speak to you and tell you this good news. And now you will be silent and not able to speak until the day this happens, because you did not believe my words, which will come true in their appointed time. That's why Zechariah, when he opened the door for Mary, just probably said, Come on, that's funny, people. I don't care who you are. That's funny. Someone famous said that, I think, once. Meanwhile, verse 21, the people were waiting for Zechariah and wondering why he stayed in there so long in the temple. And so when he came out, he could not speak to them. And they realized that he had seen a vision in the temple, for he kept making signs to them, but he remained unable to speak. You can imagine Zechariah has this amazing moment with this angel. And he comes out, and they're like, what took you so long? Why were you in there so long? And he's just like, you know? He can't talk. He was unable to speak, so he's like making signs. Anybody speak with their hands? I'm finding out I speak with my hands a lot. Yeah. So Zechariah's trying to say, hey, this is what happened, but he can't speak. He goes another 3 months without speaking until his son John the Baptist was born. And John was born to prepare the way for Jesus. So what we know about John is, yeah, he was related to Jesus. They were cousins. What we also know about John is he was thought to be a prophet. And he was, but he wasn't the prophet. He wasn't Elijah, even though he was acting in the spirit of Elijah, if that makes sense. He wasn't Elijah, but he was almost like the second coming of Elijah. And he even dressed like Elijah, because in 2 Kings chapter 1, it says that Elijah wore like hairy clothes and then fashioned a belt around his waist. They use the word fashioned. I like it. And what we find out in Matthew about John the Baptist, I'm just going to read it to you. John's clothes were made of camel's hair, And he made a leather belt and had a leather belt wrapped around his waist. So John was kind of a fashionista of the day. I don't think it was really the attire of the day to be walking around in hairy clothes. But for some reason, John did. Now, did he have the scriptures? You know, the book of 2 Kings was written about almost 600 years before Jesus' time, before John's time. And yeah, they might have had those scriptures, but I don't think John was like, oh, I want to be like Elijah and just start dressing. That was just what he did. It's just who he was. So he's a little bit of a fashionista, but he was also kind of ate unique food. Any unique food eaters in here? I know some of you, not even close. Okay. In Matthew chapter 3, the second part of verse 4, it says that his food was locusts and wild honey. So not only did he kind of dress a little funky, he ate funky too. He was kind of a foodie. Do you guys know what a foodie is? A foodie, I'll just read you the definition. A person having an avid interest in the latest food trends or food fads. And I've kind of been accused of being a foodie. I like trying new things. And Brandon and I went out a couple weeks ago. We had ramen. It's very good. It's unique. It has unique things in it. Cleo had nothing to do with it. She sat there and watched us patiently while we ate ramen and all the things that were floating around in it. So John ate locusts, which are like just large grasshoppers, and honey, like wild honey. So I just got thinking, hey, you know, I bet you I can find something and we can hand out samples for anybody that wants to kind of be challenged a little bit. And like, I want to like try. I would like to be like John the Baptist this morning a little bit and try. So there's this company called Don Bugito, and it's Bugito. And they make dark chocolate crickets and also coconut brittle bugitos. And so I'm like, anybody want to try a sample? I had a whole bunch of people try it first service. Come on up, like right now. We'll try to social distance as much as we can. But which one would you like to try? Would you like to try a little bit of both? Okay, let's do one of each. Yeah, there you go. Do you want the chocolate? Okay, one of each. Hey, make sure you get Katie's face on camera. Whoops, 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 whoops. It's my Bugitos thing. Okay, there you go. Hey, don't touch it.
Okay, I'm sorry.
There you go.
Thank you.
Hey, wait a minute. You got to try this one too.
No.
Yes. That's the chocolate-covered grasshopper. This is the other stuff. I'm just going to say stuff. Which one's better? The chocolate-covered ones? That's because all you can taste is chocolate, right?
The light-colored one.
Oh, these. It's like brittle. Hey, it's not donuts, Mr. Johnson, but it does have chocolate. Anybody? Nathan? Case, what do you think? You would? Well, there's some left over. Come up if you want more after. It takes on the meaning of stop bugging me in a whole new direction, doesn't it? So John was a unique man. That's all I can say. And maybe some of us have been accused of being unique. Off camera, John is trying to talk Ruth into trying. So Ruth, that is not, you're not obligated as a council person to... Yeah, there you go. Yeah. You had the real deal. I guess you can buy these at the Mariner games, but they're the chili flavored. Yeah, interesting. Okay. So John was a unique guy, right? A little bit what we would say, man, John's a little weird. Yeah, a little strange, a little bit off. But John knew exactly what he was supposed to be doing. And he knew that his purpose was to prepare a way for Jesus, to prepare a way for the Messiah to come. Now, as we read in the book of John, John the Baptist is going to make a couple statements that are a little confusing, because we know by what we read that they were related. We don't know how much time they spent, that Jesus and John spent together as they were growing up. We don't know that. But John's going to make this statement like, I myself did not know him, but. And you're like, well, wait a minute, John the Baptist, how can you say you didn't know him? Because you actually do know him. And what he's saying is, as we read it, is, and I won't stop, I'll stop and talk about it now, is like, I myself wouldn't have known that Jesus was the Messiah unless God pointed it out to me. I wouldn't have known unless God made it obvious to me. And we're going to see how he made it obvious by when John the Baptist actually baptizes his cousin Jesus, that a dove comes from heaven as a representation of the Holy Spirit. And then God's voice speaks for everybody in that crowd to hear that this is my son. And that was the confirmation for John. And we'll read that. Hop back over to the book of John. If we continued reading in Luke, you would see that as Mary and Elizabeth are talking, Elizabeth says, oh, you know what? Mary, when you showed up and when you said hello and we were talking, the baby inside of me moved. And the Bible describes it as jumped with joy. Because John the Baptist, even in the womb, recognized the presence of his Savior. And I'm not going to be political here, but I'm just going to say God loves life. God loves life. And I don't want, like I said, I'm not going to be political this morning, but life matters to him. And so even in the womb, and the Bible in Psalm 139, read it this week. If you haven't read Psalm 139 or you haven't read it for a while, I want you to read it, because there's just beautiful description where David is saying, God, you know me. You wove me together. You designed me. You handmade me. And all the days, all my days, you know them. Before even one day even starts, you know my days. And you know why I'm here and why you created me. I mean, God knows those things. My prayer is that we would know why we're here and why he's created us. And that is to point people to him. To live for him, just like the songs we sang about today. And then to point people to Jesus so they can live for him as well. So we're back into John. And we're talking about John the Baptist. That means he was probably baptizing people. So what is baptism? What is baptism? Is that, do I have to be baptized to be saved? No. But what baptism is a picture of salvation. It's a picture of what Jesus has done. It's a physical picture. Like when we stand in the water, we stand in the water as ourselves. But then when we go back down in the water and we're like buried in the water, completely submerged, not for very long, hopefully, for seconds, right? Unless you got a mean pastor just holding you down there, okay? Be nice to your pastors. Pastor Marcy, when she baptizes you, you watch out. And then you come up out of that water, it's like the Holy Spirit is like a fresh start. It's a lot like this picture this morning. A sunrise reminds us that we have a brand new start. We have a fresh beginning. It reminds us of this word that says that his mercies are new every morning and that his faithfulness towards us is great. And so when we come up out of the water, we come up like risen. We were dead in our sins, the Bible says. But now we are alive in Christ. And our last baptism was Douglas, and it was so awesome. We did it out in the summer out here. And it's such a powerful picture of what God does for us and has done for us and is doing for us. And we're going to have a baptism soon if we have people sign up. If you've never been baptized before in water, I was baptized as a baby. We have the pictures. It was had to be hand sketched because there's no cameras back then. No, I'm just kidding. We have black and white pictures of me being sprinkled. And I've got this cute little white dress on. Long dress, whatever. And they poured water on my head. And I probably did cry. That was a dedication. That wasn't a baptism. Because a baptism is like, man, you get a fresh start. I didn't make that decision when I was a little baby to follow Jesus. My parents made the decision to dedicate me to Jesus, which I praise them for. I thank them for. When you're baptized, you make the decision to follow Jesus. And it's your decision to say, God, I choose to die to myself. I choose to go under the water and come back up a brand new person. I choose to say that your mercies are new every morning and that your faithfulness is great. So if you've never been water baptized, we'd love for you to be baptized. It is a celebration. It's not a sad, somber thing. It should be loud and victorious. And I always say, hey, when they come up out of the water, let them know that we are celebrating with them. And so it should be loud and victorious. So if you are interested in being water baptized, we have signups back in the foyer. And so please sign up before you go. If you're interested and you're at home and you can't be here, text me and let me know. We'll sign you up. And then sometime, maybe in March, we'll bring the thing right in here and we'll do baptisms during service or after service, depending on how it goes. Because I know some of our kids want to be baptized. We have a few youth that want to be baptized as well. Isn't that an exciting thing? To celebrate new life. Does baptism, again, does it mean that we're saved? Yes, it means that we're saved. But this isn't a way to salvation. It's just obedience. Jesus was baptized. And then he tells us, hey, go and make disciples and then baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And so that they'll live for me and they'll be reminded. It's such a beautiful picture. And a lot of times in our culture, we don't really think much of baptism. We're like, oh yeah, it's a nice service. But in the Muslim world, if you were to be baptized, they know exactly what it means. I'm dying to my old self. I'm dying to my old stuff. And they also know that when they're baptized, they're, especially if from in a Muslim family, they are shunned and they are considered dead to their original family. It's a huge commitment to be baptized. And so I hope that we have a little bit of that commitment. And just know that, yeah, this is an act of obedience. One of the biggest things I get from people about being baptized is, I don't want my hair to look weird when I come up out of the water. And that was Douglas's biggest argument. I mean, everybody look back at him and you'll see why. Okay. Yeah. It's really about dying to ourselves and then living for him. It's a commitment. I'm dying to myself and I'm going to live for him. So John chapter 1, verse 19. We're going to read a little bit about John the Baptist, and he has some of the best quotes in the New Testament. One that's not even here is that he must increase and I must decrease. I almost wore my shirt. You guys see the shirt that says, it's he with a greater sign and I? Have you guys seen those bumper stickers or the shirts? And I'm like, I don't get what that means. Because it's the greater sign. I wasn't in math, but it's the sign here. That he is greater, so he is greater than I. That's what John said. That's one of John the Baptist's quotes. That he must increase, that Jesus must increase, and I must step out of the way. I need to get out of the way. I must decrease. And that's for all of us who follow him. Less of us and more of him. And that is my prayer all the time. Jesus, less of me and more of you, please. Less of me and more of you. Chapter 1, verse 19 in John. Now, this was John's testimony when the Jewish leaders in Jerusalem sent priests and Levites to ask him who he was. He did not fail to confess, but confessed freely, "I am not the Messiah." They asked him, "Then who are you? Are you Elijah?" He said, "I am not." "Are you the prophet?" And he answered, "No." Finally, they said, "Who are you? Give us an answer to take back to those who sent us. What do you say about yourself?" And then John replied in the words of Isaiah the prophet, "I am the voice of one calling in the wilderness, make straight the way for the Lord." Now the Pharisees who had been sent questioned him, "Why then do you baptize if you are not the Messiah, nor Elijah, nor the prophet?" "I baptize with water," John replied, "but among you stands one you do not know. He is the one who comes after me, the straps of whose sandals I am not worthy to untie." This all happened at Bethany on the other side of the Jordan where John baptized. There's a great quote right here when they are asking him, and John, "No, I'm not the prophet. No, I'm not the Messiah. No, I'm not Elijah." And he says, "I'm the voice of one crying in the wilderness, make straight the way for the Lord." Some translations say to prepare a way for the Lord, that John the Baptist came to prepare a way. It's like he was sent first to let people know that the Messiah is coming, that the Savior is here. He came to point people to the light. In a crazy world where it was so dark, in a crazy world where people were going after everything to satisfy themselves, and it left them more empty, so it got more wicked, more dark. And even in the darkness, they couldn't see the light. And so John prepared the way. Church, our responsibility, if you want to know why we're here, and I challenged you at the very beginning, like, who are you living for? We're living for him. We need to be living for him. And what are we supposed to be doing? We need to be preparing the way. Man, I was super convicted yesterday walking my neighborhood and praying for my neighbors. And the Lord said, "You need to care about these people, because without me, they're lost. And you need to point them to the light." And what does that look like? I don't know right yet. Do I have to go knock on doors, and Cleo's going to bake cookies and brownies, and we're going to, right now with COVID, would people not want them? I don't know. I don't know what that looks like. But I'm going to follow him. I'm going to trust him. And he's saying, "I want you to know these people. So I'm going to follow what Jesus has asked me to do. Maybe I need to get out there more often and pray. Maybe I do need to just say hi and be friendly. I'm friendly when they walk by my house and stuff. Don't get me wrong. Okay, I don't spray them with my water hose or tell them to get off my lawn. You know, that type of stuff. Okay. You know, we need to be the ones preparing the way and point people to Jesus, that he is the light. What I love about John is Jesus describes John later on as like the greatest man who had ever lived. Greater than Adam, greater than David, greater than Solomon. And yet John was so humble. I mean, they're asking him, "Are you all these things?" Could he have said, "Yes, I'm a prophet"? He could have, because he was a prophet. But what he said was, "Man, I'm not even worthy to serve Jesus." And what a servant would do is would take off the sandals and wash feet. And John the Baptist says, "I'm not even worthy to untie his sandals." That's how humble this man was. And so my encouragement is, man, as we serve Jesus, let's do it with humility. Let's do it for the sake of other people and not for our sake. Not to notch our belts or to make us look good, but it's all about pointing people to the light. Verse 29 says, "The next day, John saw Jesus coming towards him and said, 'Look, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world.'" Another amazing quote from John. He sees Jesus, and they know what a lamb is. They know the sacrificial system. And he says, look, the Lamb of God. Look, the one who came to sacrifice himself for us. Look, the one who said he would lay his life down so that we can have life. This is the one who's going to take away our sin. This is the one who's going to sacrifice himself on our behalf. In verse 30, this is the one I meant when I said, a man comes after me has surpassed me because he was before me. That's your little riddle for the week. Take that home and think about it. Jesus had always been. John came to prepare the way, and then Jesus finished his work. Verse 32, then John gave this testimony. I saw the Spirit come down from heaven as a dove and remain on him. And I myself did not know him, but the one who sent me, God who sent me to baptize with water, told me, the man whom you see the Spirit come down and remain is the one who will baptize with the Holy Spirit. I have seen, John says, and I testify that this is God's chosen one. John is saying, this is the one that we've been looking for these 400 years of silence. This is the Messiah. Jesus is the one. We need to look to him. Now, did they? Some. Majority looked right past him. Looked right past him. Because Jesus didn't come as a conquering king, as what we would think as a conquering king. Jesus conquered, but he conquered sin and death. And he did it behind the scenes, and we didn't even know it. They thought it was going to be that Jesus would come with a sword. John says, I have seen, and I testify that this is God's chosen one. John says, I didn't really know him. I wouldn't have known him. But I know that I needed a Savior, and God made it obvious to me. God told me that, hey, the one with the dove descends on, he will baptize with the Holy Spirit. He will fill us and give us everything we need to live this life for Jesus, for him. And I'd like to point you this morning to the light. If you're watching at home or watching whenever or wherever, I want to point you to the light and make sure you're looking to Jesus and you're not looking past him. And if you're in the house, I want to make sure that every single one of you are looking to Jesus as the light of the world, the one who came and gave his life for us. If you're looking for a Savior, I would ask that you would consider Jesus. A lot of people claim that they can save and they can give you everything that you want or need. You see it, just turn on that big box, and well, it's not a box anymore, that big flat screen thing in your house. There's all kinds of claims on that thing. We need to look to Jesus, and if you have never given your life to Jesus and followed him and surrendered your life to him and said, Jesus, I'm going to do what we sang about this morning. I'm going to live to love you. God, I want to live this life for you and not for myself. If you've never made that decision, it's just simple prayer to just say that. God, I'm tired of living for myself. It doesn't work. It hasn't worked. I don't think it'll ever work, and I need you. And well, we just read that Jesus said that he came to save us from our sin, our brokenness, and to heal us so we can walk in fullness with him. If you've never made that decision to follow Jesus, I encourage you to have a conversation with God. And maybe for some of us who have been a Christian for a long time, maybe it's getting back to some of the basics. And like, who are we preparing the way for? I mean, honestly, I find myself that I'm preparing the way for me. I want to make my life as comfortable as it can be. I want to have the nice things, right? I want this. I want that. I am lost without Jesus. And so I'm going to lead an empty, unfulfilled life if I'm preparing the way for me. Or even if I'm preparing the way for others that I love. Like, I'll just use an example. For like our kids. Are we preparing the way for our kids? And we so focus on their success and all their stuff. And yet we forget the most important thing. And the most important thing about us raising our kids is that they would know Jesus. I mean, that's the most important thing. Our kids can be as successful as the world would say, yes, great job, parents. And yet, if they don't know Jesus, we have not done a good job. So who are we preparing the way for? I just want to challenge us. I challenge myself. Hey, when I share up front, I've been chewing on this all week long. I've been hammering myself all week long. And so who are we preparing the way for? And I want Jesus to come into my neighborhood. And I want people to know him. I want people to know that they can be saved. And they don't have to live in the squirrely, dark, weird, twisted world right now. That they can have hope right now. It could be like this sunrise. And we know that his mercies are new, like right now. So I just want to challenge us as a church. Who are we preparing the way for? I hope we're preparing the way for Jesus to come into people's lives. That we're going before Jesus and letting people know that there is a Savior, that there is a light in the midst of darkness. And we're pointing people, look at her. Not even planned, but that there is light in the midst of crazy darkness. And then there's Jesus. It really is that simple. People are looking for a Savior right now. They're looking for answers right now. And you have the answer, church. And the good news is Jesus. I can't oversimplify it that much. It's really just pointing people to him. So as you're preparing the way for him, that means you are living for him and that you are making a difference for him, because people see it. If you're not living for Jesus and you're just talking about him all the time, people are looking at you like, it doesn't line up. 1 + 1 is weird. It doesn't work. It's not working. But if you're living for him, and then when you do speak, they know, because they've seen you live for him. Let's pray together. And God, I pray that prayer this morning, that there'd be people who are in the house and watching from home who don't know you, that today they would, for just somehow your Holy Spirit enlighten them, and they see that Jesus is their Savior. God, that this week, even right now in this moment, they would have a conversation with you, and they would surrender their lives to you. That they would start brand new, that they would understand that your mercy is new every single morning. That your faithfulness is great towards them. That you love them. That your love for them is wider, higher, deeper. That you are everything that they've been looking for. And more. So much more. And Lord, help us as your church. For those of us that have already said yes to you and are living for you. Help us to really do that. To live for you, to be like John and prepare the way for people to know you, to walk with you, and to understand you. Challenge us this week. Lord, we pray for our neighbors right now. Lord, as we drive through our neighborhoods, God, open our eyes so we wouldn't be numb. Not even thinking about them. but they are lost and dying without you. Help us to live for your kingdom, Jesus. And we thank you that your faithfulness is great. And we thank you that your mercy is new. And we say that this morning, that we live to love you, Jesus. In your name, amen. Well, blessings to you, church. Looking forward to just talking with you. You can text me anytime, email me, call me. Our phone numbers are in the directory. If you didn't want to stand up and come forward and taste bugs this morning, they're up here if you want to try some coconut worm brittle or some chocolate-covered crickets, then you're welcome to do that. I'll see Pete's going to be running up here in just a few seconds, all right? Blessings to you guys.